Hey, what's up guys, and welcome back to Anime King 2. And today I'm going to be giving you part 15 of Naruto, the God of Shinobi. Remember to get this one to 100 likes as usual, share to all their friends on your social media platform, and if you haven't yet, what are you waiting for, new viewer? Go ahead and click that red subscribe button and join the Anime King family and be a part of the channel. And also, I am going to be posting 2 What If on my main channel tonight, so switch across and enjoy. And yeah, without further ado, let's get straight into it. Start the intro. You can change. You satisfy the rage in me. Take away my pain. You satisfy the rage in me. So last time we left off, Sasuke and Itachi battle. Sasuke came out as a victor, as he now possessed the eternal Mangekyo Sharingan, as Mikoto implanted the eyes. Naruto went back to Konoha, as he was planning on destroying it from within. So he returned like nothing happened, as he managed to calm Tsunade down, and she let him back in the village, without really questioning him. Because he told her that Jiraiya wasn't teaching him, so he went off to get trained by other peoples. So she wanted a demonstration of his power, but he was tired, so she told him that she wanted to see him tomorrow. With that, Naruto nodded and headed off. He also came back at the village to look for what Mikoto Uzumaki left behind, as Naruto found a map as he was getting closer to what Mikoto left behind. Even Tsunade is looking for what her grandmother left behind, but she cannot find it. But Naruto is getting closer. So yeah, that was mainly it. So let's start this new episode. Oh yeah, if you guys haven't yet, switch across the playlist and check out from part 1. If you're new, but if you're all caught up, yeah, let's continue. Damn it, Tsunade said. Please calm down, Lady Tsunade, said Shizune. They didn't find anything, Tsunade thought. She had sent a team of Anvu to search the village underground network for anything that might look suspicious, but they came back empty-handed. So that means that her grandmother wasn't up to anything. But why doesn't that make her feel better? There was a knock on the door. As the elders then walked in. Huh? Not these old farts, thought Tsunade. Greetings, Tsunade, said Homura in a friendly tone. As he and Koharu and Danzo walked in, Tsunade sighed. Alright, I am going to say this once. I am not in the mood, so cut the crap and tell me why you're here. Both Homura and Koharu had annoying looks on their face, but Danzo kept his usual emotionless look. Well, said Koharu, we just heard something interesting. Oh, and what is that? Tsunade said. That Uzumaki Naruto has returned. Yes, he has, said Tsunade. Homura and Koharu were getting more and more annoyed. So why hasn't he been arrested? Said Homura as he raised his voice a bit. Arrested? Repeated Tsunade. Last time I checked, he didn't break any laws. Have you forgotten that he left the village without permission? Stated Koharu more calmly. And why he wasn't listed as a rogue ninja? Well, I don't know. Rogue ninja? Said Tsunade. Age must be getting to the both of you, she said, as a tick mark appeared on both of their heads. But Danzo didn't say a word, or his face expression didn't change. Let me tell you, Naruto was on a training trip that I authorized. Really? Spoke Danzo for the first time, with some sarcasm in his voice. Because it would seem that you and Jiraiya lost track of him. I doubt that that counts as a training trip. Tsunade looked at him. I never said that he was training with Jiraiya alone, did I? He merely finishes training by himself, nothing else to it. Well, if that is that, now then, honorable elders, Tsunade said with sarcasm in her voice, will you guys please leave my office so I can continue my duties. The two left, leaving Danzo alone as he looked at Tsunade. I know that you don't buy that excuse, and if you do, that is pathetic. I know you care about that boy, but he's up to something. I only hope that you open your eyes before it is too late and he completes what he's here to do. Danzo said as he walked out, as that got Tsunade thinking, as she wondered if Naruto was really up to something. With Pain and Zetsu. Zetsu looked at Pain. You are now in charge of capturing the Kyuubi Jinjuriki, and Tobi, expect that there will be no failure. Pain didn't turn and looked at him. I thought I was supposed to deal with the female Uchiha. Yes, she comes first, said Zetsu. But Tobi wants you to know that the Kyuubi will be your target once you dealt with the female Uchiha. It will be done, said Pain, as Zetsu sink back into the ground. It seems that you are right, said Konan softly as she came into the room. Yes, Pain looked at the village from the balcony that he was sitting on. It was still raining. Why do I get the feeling that things will get a lot worse from here on out? Konan said. No, Konan, you shouldn't be thinking that way. We will capture all the tail beasts, including the Kyuubi, and then peace shall come to this world. Back with Naruto. Damn it, Naruto said. This place is messed up. Stop your whining, Naruto, because we're almost there. As Naruto stopped in front of a dead end, he was currently in the third floor of the underground system. This is where the map points to, but there is nothing, he said, as he stopped and looked around. He then turned his Rinnegan on. What is it? Asked Kurama. Thanks to the Rinnegan, Naruto was able to see the chakra running through the wall as it all went to a paper seal that was placed into the middle. Only someone with a dojutsu would be able to find this, thought Naruto. Indeed, agreed Kurama. Naruto placed his hand on the seal as he flared his own chakra, making the seal break in half. Naruto stepped back as the wall started to shake and then crumble into pieces. He then shut off his Rinnegan. As he walked in, he then saw a scroll in the back wall. As he made his way towards it with caution. Who knows if Mito had set any booby traps. As he stood in front of it, there was no traps. He then pulled the scroll from the wall. Something tells me that this is it, said Kurama. I agree, said Kushina. Naruto then opened the scroll, as it was a letter addressed to him. Naruto then started to read it. Greetings, young Uzumaki. There is no doubt in my mind that you have a lot of questions at the moment, but I will try my best to answer them all. First, let me congratulate you for finding this. This also means that everything is going according to plan. And this raises the first question. How? How do I know about this? The answer, whether you will believe it or not, lies in the man that history shows as a traitor and a failure. The reason I know all about this is because he used his final form of his dojutsu, the Rinnegan. To not beat around the bush, the man that I'm talking about is Uchiha Madara. Yeah, that is right. Uchiha Madara is the man that is responsible for me knowing what I know. He only told me these things so I could help him with his revenge on the village. But it does not matter to me. The fact that my clan is gone and yours, that is the only reason that matters to me. I know that you don't feel as strongly as I do about this because you never really met them, but I do. But because you're reading this, that means you plan to destroy the village, so that is good enough for me. Back to the topic, Uchiha Madara, thanks to the Rinnegan that he gained after fighting my husband, the first Hokage Hashirama, and thanks to it, I was able to see what would happen in the future, and who and what you are. You must be wondering what I'm talking about, but don't worry, someday you will know and you will know how special you are. After he told me, I planned for a way for you to find all of this out, and thanks to the Kyuubi, that made it possible. I knew that you would somehow end up being the third Jinjūki, but I didn't know the circumstances. Madara was never specific. I never questioned it. Somehow Madara maintained his youth that even surpassed the Uzumaki clan. But by the time you're reading this, he should be dead. So while I was old and weary, he was still young. Not a teenager though, but young. At least younger than me in appearance. So I wouldn't have a chance against him. Not that I would have tried to fight him, even if I would be on my top condition. Now, that is how I know all of this. You will have your own method to do this, as well as your own allies. I also know that taking revenge for the Uzumaki clan isn't your main reason or concern. But like I said, it does not matter to me. As long as Konoha get what it deserves, I will be happy. I wish you luck. And if you have any other question left, they will be answered in time. Yours truly, Uzumaki Mito. Naruto closed the scroll and closed his eyes. Uchiha Madara, said Kurama in disgust. Now I see why he challenged. Hashirama at the Valley of the End. So that is how she knew, commented Kushina. But I never imagined that Madara would be involved in this. I guess that Mito was really desperate, said Kushina. Now I see why she's pushing so hard for the village to get what it deserved. Konoha betrayed his own founders. I don't know about the Uchihas, but they betrayed the Senjus and the Uzumaki. Konoha is just a piece of trash. So Naruto, what now? We know what Mito wants us to know, so what do we do? Naruto, who was silent, started to laugh. Incredible. Who would have thought that Mito was like this? Uzumaki Mito, what a crafty woman. A couple of hours later, as Naruto was sleeping, as he was having a dream. Who are you? Said Kushina. You don't need to know that. I am here for the Kyuubi. The Kyuubi? You want to destroy Konoha? As the masked man then laughed. If you only knew what the village has done to you. Naruto then woke up in cold sweat. What was that? He said. So you're awake, said Kurama. Well, it seems like your mother consciousness is merging with yearns. Where is she? Asked Naruto. She has gone far down in your subconscious. She said that she wants to know more about your childhood. She seems certain that you wouldn't mind. Naruto then lie back on his bed. Good. I don't want her to know about this. Is that clear, Kurama? Yes, I understand, Kurama said. As Naruto lay on the bed, he knew that he would have to fight someone tomorrow. What an annoyance. Really? I was expecting that you would be happy to fight someone from this village. To kill them, not for simple sparring, said Naruto. Kurama snorted. Yeah, I should have guessed. Naruto smirked. I am surprised that you didn't. Whatever. Who do you think it's gonna be? I don't know. It could be anyone. As Naruto thought about his mother's memory, she was scared. Yes, she was. It is the night when you were born, when the masked guy extracted me from her. It was the second time in her life that she felt fear. Second? Naruto asked. Kurama nodded. Yes, the first one was when she was kidnapped by the cloud ninjas. So that's why. Why what? Kurama asks. Never mind. Naruto then narrowed his eyes. I will make sure that she never feel fear again. Big claim. I don't think that you will be able to keep it, said Kurama. And why is that? Asked Naruto. Because she cares about you. And the fact is that you're doing something very dangerous and you might get killed. I think that she will feel fear, but not for herself, the fear of losing you again. You saw it in the dream, right? She was worrying about Konoha, but in the back of her mind, she was always thinking about you. And how do you know that? asks Naruto, "Because she's your mother. And if there is something I know about you humans, is that the mother always worried about their child." "Well, most do, anyways." Naruto then chuckled, "I suppose that you're right." Kurama then snorted, "Of course I'm right. I am the Kyuubi." With Obito, he shook his head in disgust as he walked. He had arrived in Taki a couple of hours ago, looking for the seven-tailed Jinjuriki, a task that was not hard to accomplish, as he knew that every other place besides the cloud treated their Jinjuriki like garbage, so it wouldn't be hard to get her on their side. He was currently on the outskirts of the village where the Jinjuriki live, as he was sure that it wouldn't be difficult to get her to come with him. As he arrived, he noticed the breakdown place as the poor condition that it was in. But he didn't mind that. He just went and he knocked as he heard movement from inside, as the door then barely opened. "What do you want?" said a very feminine voice. "I am here to offer you a proposition," Obito said as he got straight to the point. "No, I will not sleep with you. No matter what you say you will do," said Fu. She was quite sick of being asked that by many, almost all of the men in the village. She knew that it was just some sick bet that they come up with to see who can tame the demon. They went as far to offer her money, threaten her, and many other things that she thankful she had forgotten. Obito raised an eyebrow when he heard that. "No, I am not here for that." Fu narrowed her eyes. "That's a first," she thought in anger. But she might as well just see what they came up with this time. "Then, what is your proposition?" she asked. Obito knew that if he asked to come in, she would take it the wrong way. So he decided to explain things out here. "I know for a fact that you are not treated well in this village. I also know the reason for that," he added, making Fu narrow her eyes even more. "So you're not from here, are you?" she asked. Obito nodded. "That's correct." "I will be honest, I don't care about you, least of all your past. The only reason why I'm here is because you will be important for what we plan to do." Fu looked at him straight in the eyes, trying to see if he was telling the truth or not. After a couple of seconds of this, she opened the door completely. "You still haven't told me about your proposition." Obito then looked her in the eyes. "I am here to get you out of the village, if you agree." Fu's eyes widened at this. "What did you just say?" "Why should I do that?" she asked. "People may hate me here, but at least that I am safe." "Safe? I highly doubt that." "I don't know if you're trying to deceive me or yourself, but safe is the last thing that you will be here." Fu knew that he was right. "But going with a total stranger that I don't even know, is that supposed to be safe?" Obito shook his head. "No, it isn't. But at the moment, you don't have a choice." Fu tensed when she heard that, as she was ready to prepare herself in a fight if she needed to. Obito noticed this. "No, don't worry, I wasn't talking about me. If I was, you would already be dead or unconscious." "Then who are you talking about?" she asked him. He then pointed to the path which he came from. "Those two," he said. Fu looked at the path where he pointed as she saw two men wearing cloaks walking towards them with red clothes on them. "Who are they?" she asked, as she was a little nervous. Obito just grunted as he turned to the newcomers. "This is really annoying," he said to himself. Kakashi and Hidan stopped a few feet away from them, and I thought that the Jinjuriki wasn't popular, muttered Kakashi as he gazed at the black-haired individual in front of him. "Who cares?" said Hidan, with a smirk on his face. "It just means that I will be able to get a sacrifice." As Kakashi merely grunted in annoyance at that. "Fu," Obito said, "stay behind me. You wouldn't be able to handle them." Something in her gut She wanted to fight and take them on, but something in her gut told her to just listen to Obito. Obito then activated Sharingan as he shocked both Kakazu and Hidan for a different reason. Another one, thought Kakazu, just what is going on? First that woman and now him. Something isn't right here. While Hidan screamed yes, finally I found one of you Uchiha's. Now I will just show you how strong I really am. Obito just stared at him with a blank stare as he didn't care what the both of them said. Well, you little brat, you think you're cool because you have those eyes, don't you? Said Hidan as he took out his sight. I will cut you down to pieces. Before Kakazu could even say anything, Hidan rushed in without a plan. Obito merely smirked as Hidan's staff went right through him, shocking everyone there. What? Thought an alarmed Kakazu. What kind of jutsu is that? Before Hidan could react, Obito grabbed him and sucked him into his dimension. Kakazu could only watch with wide eyes as his partner was sucked into a vortex and disappeared. Well then, that the annoying one is out of the way, how about me and you have a chat? Said Obito to Kakazu. But guys, I'm gonna be ending this episode right here. If you want to see the next part of this, you already know what to do. Like, subscribe, comment down below, and turn on that bell notification to stay posted. Remember, share to all your friends on your social media platform. And I'm gonna be posting two What If on my main channel. So go ahead and check them out and enjoy. But for now, I'm out. Peace.